Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to all of you to the Cambridge Union Society. Tonight, I know it sounds like a cliche, but we really do have a person amongst us who needs no introduction at all. So Jackie Stewart, OBE, is obviously a former 3-time Formula One world champion and leading advocate for road safety, amongst the many other myriad of things that he does in his hectic and busy schedule. Tonight, he will be talking obviously about his racing career, his life, but also hopefully giving you a few valuable life lessons about why he's been so successful. So Jackie will talk for about 40 minutes and has a couple of video clips that he'd like to show you, and then we will open it up to question and answers. So first of all, we're just going to see a brief introductory video about Jackie's life, because I'm sure that it can introduce him and give him a much better introduction to the union than I possibly could.
Jackie's words is fine. You know, that's unusual nowadays. And he's always delivered. You get frustrated because he's so obviously right, and it was so clear that you ask yourself, well, why didn't the rest of the organization see this?
I think Jackie was the most focused and the most business-oriented. And if a sponsor wanted Jackie to work for them, they knew they were going to get back with them.
Well, after we've got rid of all that rubbish, we can get back down to earth. I'll turn around this way, if I may. Tonight, I'll try and cover some of the things that happened in my life that allows me to be here tonight. Because all that you do in your life is a preparation for what's happening later on. And that's exactly where you, most of you, are right now. I was not lucky enough to be where you are. I was certainly not lucky enough to have a decent education. I'm a complete dyslexic. I can't read or I can't write correctly. Right now, if you offered me an awful lot of money, I could not recite the alphabet. I don't know it. I've never been able to learn it. I don't know the words of the Lord's Prayer. I don't know the words of our own national anthem. I've stood many times beside Her Majesty, humming, because I literally don't know the words. I've learned now to be a millisecond behind everyone else. I learned that at primary school when we went to say prayer every morning in assembly. I'd be a millisecond behind everybody with the Lord's Prayer. But right now, I couldn't, for 100 million, recite it. I just don't know it. I can't find my own name on a keyboard, so I don't use a computer. I can't work the sat-nav in my car. So I'm pretty dumb. Lots of people are who are dyslexic, educationally dumb. The bad news is the educational authorities are even dumber because they haven't found out an easy way to get their teacher training colleges to be able to recognize children and young people with learning disabilities, and it is a disability. I'm trying to change that. I've changed it in Scotland. We're the only country in the world where every teacher training college, and there's only seven in Scotland, must by law, Scottish law, passed by the First Minister and the Minister of Education. They must now teach every single new generation teacher, and there will be 20,000 new Scottish school teachers come out in the next 5 years, but they will all be able to recognise a young person from even preschool that has a learning difficulty such as dyslexia. It's been a great burden in my life. Unquestionably, the most unhappy days of my life was at school. You're told you're stupid, dumb, and thick. And my teacher was right with regards to what I could do in the field of education. But when that happens, it moves from the classroom to the playground. The clever folk don't want to talk to you. You're left with the other dummies. In my class, there were 54 people in my primary school class. So there was five of us out there. The best one was Joe Milne. He had only one sweater, short-sleeved. He had only one pair of shoes and a shirt that was short-sleeved. That's what he had, winter and summer. And he was completely dyslexic like me. I was lucky. My dad had a wee garage, nothing very big, about six employees. But we were okay. Joe Milne wasn't. And the pain and suffering he went through was colossal. The abuse that you get from the clever folk, and you're there, here we are amongst you all, was pathetic. So when that happens, it severely affects your self-confidence, your self-respect, and everything else. You just are desperate to do something that you are good at. In my case, I left school at 15. And I worked in a garage serving petrol. I made more money in tips than I did on wages because I was so desperate to get praise that I would check the tires, wipe the windscreen before it became fashionable, check their oil, check their battery oil, check their radiator, as well as fill it up with petrol. And they would give me a tip. I earned more in tips, saved up and bought an Austin A30 from my tips by the time I was 17. But in the early years, when I was about 14 or 15, that nose there wasn't broken in a fancy accident in Monte Carlo in a Grand Prix car. I wish I could tell the girls that one. Simply not true. Because you hang out with the wrong people, you're hanging out with the other dummies, I ended up going to billiard rooms. Billiard rooms are not as good as the snooker rooms that they have today. A billiard room was a rough place up a close, it was called, in Dumbarton, an old Nissen hut. And for whatever reason, I left there to walk down to catch the bus to go home, and I got set on by five guys, kicked the living daylights out of me, cracked three ribs, collarbone, and my nose. Best thing that ever happened to me, because I suddenly realized I was in the wrong place. I was with the wrong people. I never went back to the billiard hall. I started to realize that I had to be doing something else with somebody else. I started shooting, clay pigeon shooting, trap shooting. My grandfather was a gamekeeper. My other grandfather was a farmer, so I was brought up with a fishing rod and a gun in my hand. Father was a good shot, and I started clay pigeon shooting at the age of 14 and a half. My first ever competition, can you imagine, you're a total failure in school. And still at school at 14, my first ever competition, I won it. Big trophy, this high. It was on New Year's Day in Scotland. Everybody was pissed. I was the only one that was sober. And at 14 and a half years of age, I won this trophy. I won it 3 years on the trot in New Year's Day. I couldn't miss that event. My shooting gave me pride in myself. My work in the garage gave me pride in myself, self-confidence for the first time. I went on to shoot for Scotland, and then I went on to shoot for Great Britain. I won the Scottish, I won the Irish, the Welsh, the English, and the British. I won the British Grand Prix of shooting. Later won the other one for racing. I'm the only guy that's ever done that. But then again, not too many of the Grand Prix drivers shoot. But that was the beginning of learning how I had to focus, how I had to commit myself, how I had to be single-minded, how I had to make sacrifices. Helen and I, my wife's here tonight, Helen and I started going out with each other when Helen was, I think, 16, I was coming up 18. There was a tennis club and Helen's brother would have a summertime, they would have a monthly dance. All the guys would go in there and they would take rum and coke. Rum and coke because they were drinking Coca-Cola to their parents or their parents' friends because they didn't know there was rum in there. So the Coca-Cola looked okay. I couldn't take Coca-Cola and rum because I was shooting. I thought, my God, if I drink and shoot, I'll never win anything. I didn't smoke. Same reason, oh my God, it'll affect my eyes. So I learned how to focus. I learned how to make some sacrifices. And I learned how to manage my mind. Now, mind management is probably the best thing I ever learned. By the time I got into motor racing, and I'm jumping a little bit here, mind management was even more important. And mind management comes in any form that you like to have it. It doesn't matter what you're doing. If you have good mind management, you're going to have a considerable advantage over the competition or the people that you're competing against for a better job, for a better situation, for more privileges. Because the moment that you allow your emotion to get the better of you, you start making mistakes. Emotions are a very dangerous thing. I learned how to eliminate emotion. If somebody gets angry, and they really get angry, they will unquestionably say some things that they wish later they had never said. The trouble is they've said them, and they will be remembered by whoever was in the receiving end. If you get overly enthusiastic, and before you got the money in the bank, the deal's not done. You can say the deal's done in a handshake, you can get carried away, you can go out for dinner or a drink or a party or do whatever you like. You don't do it until the money's in the bank. So therefore, emotionally, you've got to be very clean. By the time I started driving a racing car, I had already learned through my shooting how to get this management working in my head. In shooting, much more difficult than driving racing cars, playing tennis, playing golf, almost any other sport. Because when a target gets up and it's fired and you go after it, and an Olympic trench target is traveling sometimes 135 miles an hour, another target going exactly the same trajectory at the same height is only doing 50 miles an hour. You've got to be able to instantly recognize what's fast, what's slow, what's angled, etc. If you miss a target, you never get it back. Now, if you're a golfer and you hit a drive and it slices or hooks and goes into a bunker, you can come out of the bunker sometime magically and still get par. If you make a small error of judgment in a racing car, the same thing applies. Whoops-a-daisy, get it together, and you can either make up that time on that, even that lap, because we might have 16 or 23 corners. You can make up a wee bit of time. In shooting, you can't. The moment you miss that target, it never comes back. So you're only going to get 99 out of 100 or 199 out of 200, which would be the international big events. So I won the European and Mediterranean Championship in trap shooting. I was reserved for the two-man Olympics. I shot for Great Britain in, it was a four-man team when we did the World Championships and the European Championships. In fact, they were more difficult to win than the Olympics because there was only two competitors from each country rather than four. So I learned the mind management before I ever drove a racing car. And when I got into a racing car, that helped me. I went straight into a racing car and did quite well. My first race, I finished second. Second race, I won. I was a mechanic in the garage, a very rich young man in Glasgow. His family wouldn't allow him to race. For the family trust, he was the only son. So he bought lovely cars, but got other people to drive them. I was the mechanic. So as a reward for my preparation of his cars, he gave me a chance to drive. When I drove his car, I did quite well, was seen by a team called the Écurie Écosse, the Scottish team that won Le Mans a couple of times, brought along some great drivers. I got to drive for them. They took me to national racing. And then Ken Tyrrell saw me, and that took me to international racing. In Formula 3, my very first Formula 3 race, I won. The first time I went abroad to race a car of any kind was a Formula 3 car at the Monaco Grand Prix. And I got pole position and won the race. And in those days, and still happens, by the way, if you win the race, and keep in mind this was a long time ago before most of you were born, when you won the race in those days, the winner of the Formula 1 race and the winner of the Formula 3 race and their wives sat at the table of Prince Rainier and Princess Grace. So the winner of the Formula 1 was on one side of Princess Grace and I was on the other side of Princess Grace. Not a bad prize. However, the money in the Formula 3 race then for winning was as much as third place in the Formula 1 race. Helen and I had no money. I mean, at that time, I bet I hadn't £50 between us. We had no money. When we went to Monte Carlo to race, we drove down rather than fly because we couldn't afford to fly. We stayed with Bruce McLaren overnight in Surbiton. He was doing the Monaco Grand Prix, but he was flying. So therefore, we drove down, stayed with him overnight. He would leave later the next day to fly. We had to go to Dover and then drive down to Monte Carlo. We stayed with him, got out of his apartment in the morning, had a little plastic briefcase, put Helen in the car, put the baggage in the car, left the briefcase in the roof of the car outside. Drove off, whoops-a-daisy, off comes the plastic briefcase on the road. Bruce spots it, takes it to the local police station. By the time we got to Dover, we're getting there, and I said to Helen, get the briefcase out, get a hold of the tickets and the passports. I haven't got them. I said, of course you've got it, like any man would. So, no, I haven't got it. I said, for God's sake, look for the damn things in the car. Of course, it's back in Surbiton. Phone up, Bruce McLaren and his house. Somebody says, yes, we found the briefcase. It's at the local police station. I have to drive back, both of us driving back to Dover, by which time it was now too late to drive to Monte Carlo because we were very tight for time because of hotel costs. Couldn't get a flight directly to Nice. Had to go through Geneva to get to Nice. We only had enough money for one-way tickets. I know I could have left the wife behind. But as most of the men know in this room, we'd get aggro. So I thought, we'll do the one-way ticket. We got to Monte Carlo, we got a ride, hiked a lift to get to the little wee hotel we were living in. It's a fairy tale. And then walked to the track the next morning because we had no rental car, from Rock Brun, it was called. It's just further towards Italy than Monte Carlo itself. Anyway, went on to win the race. The best thing that ever happened was that the first man to properly congratulate me in winning the race was a man called Fangio, who was the most wonderful man in the world for me. The finest racing driver that's ever lived. Dignity and style, an amazing man. And to have Fangio come while I was still in the car to congratulate me was just one of the biggest moments of my life. And one of the biggest moments of my life, one of the most important things I've done in my life, is to carry Fangio to his last resting place. So I went to Argentina for his funeral, and it happened within 24 hours of him dying. That's the Argentinian way. And that was a big deal for me. He was such a hero as far as I was concerned. So from Formula 3, went into Formula 2 in the same year as Formula 3, in fact, won a race in that, and then was invited towards the end of that year by Cooper, by Lotus, and by BRM to drive the following year in Formula 1. Chose BRM because Graham Hill was going to be a better tutor to me as a number two driver than Jim Clark, who was one of my best friends. We shared an apartment in London together. It was actually somebody else's apartment. It was John Whitmore. Sir John Whitmore had the apartment in Mayfair, Balfour News, was it called? Fancy place. We called it the Scottish Embassy. So I lived with Jimmy. So I was learning a lot from Jimmy, but I was learning more of the technical stuff from Graham. And I was lucky enough in the first year to win a Grand Prix, to finish third in the World Championship, finished second to Jim Clark in three races, the Belgium, the French, and the Dutch Grand Prix. For me at that time, to be on a podium with Jim Clark, two Scotsmen, but he was such a wonderful driver. To be on a podium with him was a big deal. So things went on, and we got from there into BRM, turned out to be not too successful after a while. The second year and the third year, they had a ridiculously heavy H16 configuration of a 3-litre formula. I mean, the engine was a monster. And when you get a monster engine which takes monster fuel and monster oil and monster water, suddenly the thing is a wet and heavy monster, which doesn't handle nearly as well as an agile, lighter, better car. So I stuck with it because Graham went to Lotus to drive the new Ford engine with Jim Clark. I stayed with BRM to be the number one driver. And that was a good thing to do, to learn to be the number one driver, to learn to lead the others, to learn how to lead the technology, the engineers and the mechanics and so forth. You need that kind of experience. I don't know how many of you in here break for summer and do work experience, but I would highly recommend it. In America, that's something that happens all the time. Every student in America, almost, at university, they call it college, work all their vacations, not only to get experience, but to earn money, because their costs are very high in America. My son, our son, went to Duke, and now our grandson, our eldest grandson, is going to go to Duke as well. I would say to be able to get hands-on experience in something that you feel you would like to be in the future is a very positive thing to do. Because education is wonderful. It's the greatest loss of my entire life is my education. But having seen what goes on in education, school's a wonderful place. The people who are teaching you are sometimes very good, but they're telling you to do things that they themselves may never have done. If you've got hands-on in something, you will gain further knowledge beyond the educational requirement. Now, there's nothing wrong with having the educational requirement. It's a very valuable thing to have and a privileged thing to have. But you've got to know what it feels like. because you may find you're not doing the thing that you've been educated to do. You may think your skill falls into another basket, or this is not exactly what I wanted to do. But even if it's the thing you want to do, then you will get more out of it by physically and mentally being part of it, even before you finish your education. I think it's a very worthy thing to do. So, I continued racing, joined Ken Tyrrell, and he was an amazing man to work with, a real leader of men. Leadership is an important thing. Not everybody has it. The cleverest people in the world sometimes don't have it. It's something that really you're born with sometimes. Every one of his mechanics he chose fastidiously, who they were, what they did, where they came from, and what skills, natural abilities they had beyond being mechanics. Because everybody has to get on together. You have to have teamwork. You cannot have one superstar who thinks he can do everything, upsets the team. It's not the way to deal with it. Ken Tyrrell was a great judge of people. So he had wonderful people. And when I joined him to drive for the Matra team, the French Matra team had their business was satellites and exercise missiles and all sorts of stuff. And in fact, the car was designed by two nuclear physicists. One of them had never seen a race, but in fact knew what he was going to do and was a great asset. But there had to be a practical side, and that practical side was called Ken Tyrrell and his mechanics. I won the world championship the second year of the Matra, finished second in the world championship the first time out, and it was a wonderful car. But the French being the French, they said, if we can make a chassis, we can also make an engine. So they decided they wanted to do a 12-cylinder engine instead of keeping the 8-cylinder Ford Cosworth engine, which turned out, in any case, to be the finest racing engine that's ever been created. Ford Motor Company put the money up for it and developed it with Cosworth. Mike Costin and Mike was a brilliant man, and Costin as well. So Cosworth and Costin made Cosworth. And I won, of my 27 Grand Prix victories, I won 25 of them with the Ford Cosworth engine. It was a fantastic engine, and that was more than any other driver ever did. But it was such a reliable engine, such an easy engine to drive. It was not giving you a kick in the backside every time you touched the gas pedal. It came onto power nicely, it came out of power nicely. So we had success with the Matra, winning the world championship very early in the season. They then went off with the 12-cylinder, and I said I couldn't do that. I had to stay with the Ford engine. Ken Tyrrell didn't have a car. Nobody would sell us a car. Lotus wouldn't sell us a car because they didn't want the competition of Ken Tyrrell and Jackie Stewart. Brabham wouldn't sell us a car. Lola were going to make one and then pulled out. So we were left to buy a March, which was a brand new car, turned out to be reasonably fast, very difficult to drive, and very basic because it was made very quickly for a very small amount of money in comparison to the competitors. So it was a pretty rough diamond. Lost the world championship to Jochen Rindt, who was later sadly to die. But the Lotus at that time, the Lotus 49, was a giant success. Wonderful racing car. And that was still going. It was running when I was racing against Jochen the previous year when I won the world championship. But there was nobody to compete with him, Ferrari or anybody else, that following year. So in 1970, Jochen was the best driver in the world with the best car. But tragically, lost his life at Monza towards the end of the season and was killed through a mechanical failure in the car. He was a very good friend. He lived a few hundred meters away from where we lived, and we traveled together, we lived together more or less. At that time, Colin Chapman's cars were incredibly fragile. There were more people killed in Lotuses than any other racing car. And death in those days was something that we lived with almost on a daily basis. We killed, in 1968, we killed a driver every month. April 7th, Jim Clark died. May the 6th, Mike Spence died. June the 7th, Ludovico Scafiotti died. Joe Slessor died in July, same weekend. And we were racing at the Nürburgring on the same weekend in August. It was that race that was in the fog and the rain. You couldn't see 50 metres. And they would never have started the race today. It was ridiculous. The Nürburgring in those days was the old circuit. 23 kilometres or 14.7 miles around. 187 corners per lap. A giant. Now, there's a funny thing. There's Mr. Dyslexic here. Can't recite the alphabet. Right now, I would, just for 10 million, if you can put your hands in your pocket, I could give you every gear change and every braking distance of the Nürburgring. Now, how can you account for that and still not do the alphabet? So I won the race by more than 4 minutes. And the first thing I said when I got out the car was, is everybody all right? Because I fully expected. The Nürburgring, if a car went off the track, you never saw it. It was either a 500-foot drop-off or you were into the trees. So that was a bad year. It went on. In fact, from 68 to 73, which was my best years, if you raced at that period, for a five-year period, which it was, there was a 2 out of 3 chance you were going to die. A 1 out of 3 you were going to live. Ridiculous. I went to Switzerland that year to live in 68. Helen and I, with 2 little boys, moved to Switzerland from Scotland because Mr. Wilson was the Prime Minister. And Mr. Wilson was charging me 93% tax. I made £100,000. That was it. Now, I know £100,000 is not much worth to you guys, and you girls are so well off, but £100,000 to me, in 1968, the value of £100,000 today would be even bigger. I moved to Switzerland, and there's a thing called the forfait system in Switzerland, where you pay what they think you can afford. And you go there with your blue jeans with holes in them and your shoes, and you say, and I could honestly say I was a relatively poor racing driver at that time, because I really hadn't hit the big time. I certainly hadn't won the world championship. And I think my tax that year was 1%. But it doesn't last forever. I think it lasted 5 years. You know what the son of a bitches did? They reassessed me after 5 years. They doubled it. So anyway, I retired at the end of 73. Won the world championship in 71. Bad year for me. I got something called mononucleosis. You know, you must know what mononucleosis is. A bunch of you will have it or get it. It's burning the candle at both ends. Very popular in universities, particularly in America, colleges, burning, you know, doing the parties, getting into no good, swatting, catching up, pressure, you get mononucleosis. Not unusual. It's very weakening. I got it. I was that year racing in America and in UK. I was doing Can-Am. I was doing Formula One, Formula Two, touring cars, GT cars, and IndyCars. And I was, by that time, doing television that you saw on the screen there for ABC's Wide World of Sports, best sport channel in the world at that time. I went to America. I crossed from the UK or Europe to America that year 86 times. That's to say 46 crossings. 86 crossings. Time change, racing, working, doing commercials, doing television, etc. I was completely rooted. When I was walking along signing autographs in that little piece you just saw, that was 71. Roman Polanski made a movie that year on me called Weekend of a Champion, where ironically I won the race just by a bit of luck, because it could easily have been a retirement in the first lap for a movie. But in fact, I won the thing. Roman was a very good friend, friends of our family since the 60s, mid-60s. In fact, he's brought back Winning Is Not Enough, and it's just been selected by the Cannes Film Festival, and it'll be premiered on the 22nd of this month, next week, next Wednesday, in Cannes. So it's going to be a big deal. It's now already getting huge press over there because there's been previews of it, etc. He's updated it 40 years later. It was done in 1971. It was shown first in a movie theatre in 1972. Now, 40 years later, he's brought this thing back. And he's cleaned it up. He's got it high definition. He's changed it a bit here and there. And at the end, there's Roman and I, 40 years older, sitting in the same suite in the Hotel de Paris that we were filmed in all together in 1971. And it's a good movie. You'll see it one day. I hope it's a good movie. Everybody seems to think it's so at the moment. But anyway, why did I get on to Roman Polanski? Because of that. So therefore, that year was a tough one for me. Got my mononucleosis, recovered from it, nearly retired. Felt better by November. Okay, I'll do another year. That was 72. Had a duodenal ulcer that hemorrhaged in 72. Again, because of the pressure, the lifestyle, the running around. Didn't win the world championship. Finished second in it. Had been off for 6 weeks. Missed some Grand Prix. Went back and I nearly retired then. But went back in 73, won the world championship. Then I decided I would retire. I decided in April, never told Helen, only two people knew that I was going to retire, Ken Tittle and a man called Walter Hayes, president of Ford Motor Company at the time. And my last race would have been my 100th race. Good time to stop. And I had won the world championship by the time I got to Watkins Glen, which would have been the 100th race. Carr was good enough to win the race. Francois Sever was my teammate. And Francois got killed on Saturday and qualified. So out of respect, I withdrew from the race. So the end was not a nice way to finish, if you like. But it was the right time to finish for Jackie Stewart. Not because of Francois' death, but because I was burned out. It was time to stop. Very important to know when to stop. Schumacher did it wrong. He retired too early. He just retired too early. Fantastic racing driver. Got angry, got upset, emotional, and retired. Couldn't do without it. Started to ride motorcycles, race motorcycles. What a lunatic. And then went back, by which time people like Vettel had arrived, Hamilton properly, and a whole lot of others. Didn't care a damn who Michael Schumacher was. And of course, he was beaten. He was beaten by his own teammate, which is even worse, because that's the only measure you really have. Your own teammate. So Michael retired too early. He's now retired and he won't come back. But you've got to be careful when to stop the clock. And that judgment is vital. Since then, my world has changed commercially. As a sportsman, you have an enormous opportunity. I spoke to... who did I speak to on the way in the car? Who's the Scottish cyclist? Chris Hoy. I was on the phone to Chris Hoy on the way up here. and he's just retired and is coming down to see me to talk about where he goes from here. Motor racing's we're very lucky because we have car makers, we have tire manufacturers, we have fuel and oil suppliers. We've got components, sparking plugs, shock absorbers, all sorts of materials that we have to have. If you're a football player, you've got a pair of boots, you've got a little pair of shorts, and you've got a top. And that's it. All of which are made in Vietnam. Britain's the capital of motorsports as an industry. The capital. We employ between 40 and 50,000 people in this country in the motorsports industry alone. We are the capital. So when you're a retiring racing driver, you've got a fantastic opportunity. I was with Ford Motor Company for 40 years. I was the first to spray champagne in Formula One. I've been with them for 44 years, drinking considerably more than I spill anymore. But it's a long contract. I've been with Rolex, and if you were all speaking here tonight, you would wear a Rolex. I've been with them for 45 years. So I've had long-term relationships. Long-term relationships is what you want. To have a long-term relationship, you've got to deliver. The key to it is under-promise and over-deliver. You never get the sack. So if I were to pass some things on to you, I'd like to do that. Whatever you choose to do in your life, there's sometimes you've got to make another step, just another yard, you think, to just get the difference between what is good and what will be very good. So taking that extra yard makes a difference. Now, I've spent my life looking for that extra yard. And if I've been able to keep my relationships, I've been married to the same woman for over 50 years. Now, you may say that's very stupid. But it's been okay for us. Now, if I've been with Ford for 40 years and I've been with the other guys for 45 and 44, I've delivered. So I've had to go the extra yard to make sure that I deliver. I'm going to show you something now that my son did. Both sons, because one son's called Paul. He's the elder. He's the one that was at Duke. He decided that Jackie didn't want any cufflinks any longer or watches or what could I buy my father. So he decided instead to write a song for me. So he wrote the lyrics and he wrote the music. Then he played the guitar with this number. And George Harrison taught him to play the guitar. So he plays the guitar quite well. However, he said also he was going to sing it, which was, oh my God, I've heard the bath, I've heard the whole thing, but he sang it. So he finished this, and he did it very well. My younger son, Mark, he filmed it and edited it and stuck it together. When Paul had finished it all, he thought, where's the extra yard? And he thought, I'll have another musician. Maybe that'll help it just a wee bit. So he found another musician. I can't remember his name right now. Plays a guitar. Oh, yeah, Eric Clapton. Eric's a friend. So he gets Eric to come in. It's called, what is it called, Helen? The song. God Almighty. It's called Fly Free. Fly Free. And if the chorus is, if you fly with the crows, you're liable to be shot at. My billiard room, I was with the wrong people, right? I was flying with the crows. If you soar with the eagles, you're outside of shot. So you choose very carefully who you hang out with. You choose carefully your friends. You choose carefully who you work for and who you align yourself with. I've been lucky. I've aligned myself with some pretty good people. So this thing is called Fly Free. I'm going to sit down and let you see it, and then we might do some questions and answers. Right, play the music. That's it. That was Going the Extra Yard. And a lot of people have seen that now. Paul just did another one recently with Mark for Guy de Liberté. You know the guy who has Cirque du Soleil? He's a guy who came right up from the bottom and now is one of the most successful businessmen in the world. He's got 6 different hotels in Las Vegas playing a Cirque du Soleil, different one, etc. And he did a lovely, similar thing to this for Guy, because Guy went to the space station. He paid $23 million to get to the space station. And Paul and I are walking across the courtyard to the house last year, and the phone rings. Pick the mobile phone. Hello. Hi, it's Guy. So what do you mean it's Guy? Guy, it's Guy. I said, Guy's up in space. Who is it? I'm right above you, he said. This is him on a mobile phone from the space station to our, he was right over the UK at the time. Anyway, he's done a DVD on that. That's fantastic. He's doing things and it's great, great. Right, I'm going to ask you for questions. I don't know how many questions we'll get, but I usually judge the intelligence of the audience by the number of questions that are asked. If you raise a hand and then speak loudly, I'll try and listen to you. Any questions? Yes, sir. Now, you'll have to speak nice and loud because I've shot, I've driven racing cars. This is this year. This year's pretty dire. And this is my wife here. It's completely... So if you speak nice and loud...
I was reading at lunchtime today a Grand Prix book that I've got sitting in the office, and looked at reminded myself that Roland Ratzenberger and Ayrton Senna were killed that weekend all those years ago. You must be very pleased that since then there have been no deaths in Formula One.
Yes, it's amazing to think that we're now 19 years and 10 days exactly from we lost the life of a racing driver in a Formula One car. It's an amazing thing. These millimeters apart, these human errors, the mechanical failures, and yet we haven't lost the life of a single racing car driver in that time. Deformable structures, cars are safer, barriers are deformable, runoff areas. It's fantastic. I mean, there are more people killed riding horses, more people playing rugby than 19 years. A Formula One car has never taken a driver's life. It's amazing. It was a tough job to begin with. Nobody wanted it. There was a lot of opposition. I closed the Nürburgring, and I had death threats because... in those days, because it's such a big circuit, everybody's camped out and did bed and breakfast everywhere around that area of the Eifel-Rhenen area, the Eifel area of Germany. So it was, the economy was big, and I got life threats because I had taken away their economy. We raced there 2 years later because they had then done enough work to justify it. But it was later closed when Niki Lauda had another big accident, and again it couldn't be serviced. So today we've got safe motor racing. It's probably the thing, it's my biggest contribution to motorsport for sure, not winning the championships or anything. So I'm very happy that we're in the position we are. It won't last forever. We're going to lose somebody. You know, planes crash, ferries sink, buses crash too. So there'll be something. But in our time, I mean, I must have been at more funerals, more memorial services, seen more parents and sons and daughters and brothers and sisters than anybody else I know. It was a shocking time. So it had to be changed. But today it's very safe. Yes, the lady there. You, no, you're a lady, aren't you? Yeah. Hang on, we've got your mic.
Thank you. So if the chances of death were so high, why didn't you retire earlier?
There's a common belief, I think, with everybody that it only happens to other people. You can think like that. Obviously, that wears off after a while when it's really close friends. I mean, Helen had it worse than I had, I think, because Helen had to be with Pierce Courage's wife the minute he crashed and the minute he died for the rest of that day and night. And same with Nina Rindt when Jochen died. It's a terrible experience to be amongst that regularly. The racing driver, you know, when the visor goes down, the lights go out. When Jochen died, within half an hour, I was back in a racing car. And I did the fastest lap I'd ever done at Monza. And it wasn't with anger. The head was cool. And once I passed the corner that he died on, for the first time, it had disappeared from my life because I had to give it 110% focus in order to get a good grid position. So I got second on the grid. But it was the fastest lap I'd ever done. So it's contradictory to the emotions that I had, because before I get in the car, I have to admit that I was in tears. The visor went down, I went out. By the end of the warm-up lap, I was together. But when I come back in again, just the whole thing hit me again. I got out the car and a friend of mine, John Lindsay, gave me a Coca-Cola bottle I wanted a drink. And I just was so angry at what had happened to Jochen. I've never done it in my life before. I smashed the Coca-Cola bottle against the wall and smashed it into smithereens and burst into tears. So it doesn't stop you having emotions. But again, the mind management comes into play. And you have to do the same thing again. So I never drew blood from my body driving a racing car. I broke a few bones. Of course, there are English people around who would say there's no blood to be drawn from a Scot. But it's an anomaly. But in those days, it happened. And all of us knew about it. And we behaved accordingly. So it was the mind again. You manage the grief. You manage the re-entry program. And I have no excuse for it. And I really don't know what makes it happen. But it wasn't just me. It happened to all of us. We were all living at that time in that way. Yes, sir. Down here. You. Yes, you.
So thank you very much for your thoughts. It's been amazing. One thing that really stood out to me was your emphasis on long-term relationships and the relationships you've developed over the years. So related to that are two questions. Firstly, apart from going the last yard, what else do you do to maintain those relationships? And secondly, when you meet somebody or an institution for the first time, what do you look for that makes you confident that you can actually have a long-term relationship with them? Thanks.
Well, a good question. The last part of it, you don't make your mind up in 5 minutes. They earn your trust. They earn the wisdom that they might have. And you have to choose carefully who that person, and I don't think you should have one, by the way. I had two. I always thought I had to have two people who I could go to for counsel. And I had a few as I went along and they drifted away or I decided they were no longer, you know, I had almost outgrown them sometimes. In the end, the two people I had, one was King Hussein of Jordan, who was one of my best friends. And there was no time that I couldn't call him on a phone. It would never take 12 hours. The more important the person, the faster the response. The complete wankers take 2 days to call you back. It's a fact. They think they're the most important people in the world and they're too busy. The really important ones who are really busy find time. I had him and I had Lord King of British Airways. He ran British Airways at the time, an amazing man. And I would phone them up if I was in question of whether I was going to do the right thing or a decision I was making. Sometimes they would agree with me. Sometimes they would disagree. Sometimes I would go or not go. But they helped me see it in a clearer fashion. So I think it's good to have a couple of people. And the other side is you don't hang out with the wrong people. The crows you don't need. And when you get famous and very rich, you'll have a lot of hangers-on. You don't have hangers-on. You do away with hangers-on. You choose your friends carefully and you have them, but you don't need a bunch of them. And that's sport and entertainment. You see huge, I mean, Muhammad Ali traveled with an entourage, and a lot of other people I know still do. That's not the way to live. The long-term issue is, I mean, irrespective of having to deliver, you've got to do that. You've got to be looking all the time how you can improve the performance. You've got to improve your performance. You've got to see who's coming along in the company, who you need to be with next. You know, you can be, I mean, I was very friendly with Henry Ford II, but I got to be very friendly with Phil Caldwell because he became the next chairman. And after him, there was Don Peterson, and after him, there was Red Poling. So you had to see them before you got there. No good of kissing ass only when they get there. They've got to trust you as well. And not just because they've got the position. So you've got to judge people as they come along and see who the really good ones are as they're coming along within a company. The bigger the company, the more difficult it is. But I still, to this day, exercise that. I brought somebody back from Unilever from Barcelona on Sunday night. He's the guy who's in charge of all manufacturing of every kind that Unilever have in every country of the world. Pooh, smart as an eagle. He's Italian and really got it together. He will go beyond where he is just now. And he's one of the highest paid men in the world at the present time in his job. Now, I know him now very well. I know now the treasurer of Unilever very well. And I know the chief financial officer very well as the president. Paul Polman's the president, a Dutchman. I brought them into Formula One. But you just can't service only one person. And you choose very carefully who you align that with. Unilever is one of the best companies in the world. Look at your share prices. They're like Nestle and Philip Morris. They're always up there. Real good deliverers. Don't go to the corner laundry. So therefore, you look for the right place to be. That's about how you do it. You've got to judge people. You see them. You see them with their family. You see them in anger. You see them in happiness. You judge. You see them irresponsibly. Then you don't go that way. It's pretty simple, really. It's very common sense. Common sense is the greatest asset you'll ever have. Wonderful education, of course, boosts that. But if you don't have a nose for it, you don't have a sense, then it doesn't work so well. I think you had one early on. Yes, I think the microphone is coming down your way. Here we are, gentleman in blue. Probably French.
Thank you. So I'd like to know what are the main differences between an F1 car and an Indy car in terms of safety?
The difference between an F1 car
and an Indy car.
And an Indy car. Cost. The Formula One car budget is huge. So, and the Indy car is a one make formula. In other words, it's a Dallara or it's somebody else. And it, you know, right now we've got Red Bull and we've got the Lotus and we've got the Ferrari and we've got the McLaren and the Mercedes. All but the Ferrari made in the United Kingdom. The Mercedes-Benz is not built in Germany, it's made in England. So those cars are almost budgetless with regards to a man like Adrian Newey, who's the designer of the Red Bull car. And he's the genius of our time. These cars are made in such a fashion that Indy could not afford them. Formula One at the moment can afford them. And there are price-cutting methods being used constantly at the moment because of the global economy. But when Red Bull spend money, they're a big margin company. You know, they've got a bucket of water coming from somewhere and then they put something inside it and sell it to you. The margin is huge, very large. So their profit margins are terribly large. So they need promotion on a global basis. They go Formula One. They want a global sponsorship. They pay for performance to go with it. And therefore, Red Bull are spending more money than anybody else. Maybe Ferrari spend just about as much money, but they're Italian. So therefore, we're built in Britain, and we do a better job right now, more consistently. But that's why it's money. Money talks. And the best engineers want to go to the best companies. So here in, you know, Cambridge is a great supplier to the motorsports industry. The electronics, the computer simulation, the sensoring devices, great many of them come from this place here. We've got a sort of corridor from Cambridge to Oxford of engineering skills that we take out, many from this university city. So, you know, you get the brains, they go where the best opportunities are, and you find the new dimensions that other people haven't yet thought of. So that's where it comes from. Yes, at the back there, right at the very back, on the far side. There we are, we're passing it along.
Hello. It must have been very hard for a wee boy from Scotland whose dad owned a garage to suddenly go from that sort of situation to having lots of great relationships with very important men in business. Do you think it's, you know, a lot of people would say that you've beaten the odds. Do you think it's hard? Do you think it's harder now for a person to do the same as what you've done? Do you think it's harder in these times?
Yes, I think so. I mean, I thought I was tall, actually. You said I was a wee boy. Are you Scottish?
Yeah, I am, yes.
Lucky boy, huh? That's the great thing about sport. If you're good at something and you excel in it, people want to know you. They want to be part of you. They want to get close to you. And you see a lot of these people, and they could be either sycophantics or just hangers-on. So you've got to be careful you don't collect them. But if you deliver successfully in whatever field you're in, I don't care whether you're a dentist or a lawyer or anything, if you deliver better than anybody else, more people come to you. You get more access. You get more privileges. You earn more money. And if you behave yourself, the chances are you align yourself with some very good people. The people who were on that screen earlier on, the introductory DVD, Martin Sorrell's first job was my PA. And he's a hugely successful man now. I'm not saying that I had anything to do with that, although I claim I made him. But I've never lost a friendship of Martin Sorrell. Sean Connery's a very good friend. So he did his little piece there. All the other people that were featured there, Edsel Ford, another very good friend. If you align yourself with good quality people, they themselves have success that you can be part of. And it's very easy. You know, we talked about Eric Clapton earlier. George Harrison was one of my best friends, one of our best friends. And so is Eric, a good friend. So is the drummer from Pink Floyd. You know, a whole bunch of the music people are really good friends. So you get to be with them, and then you choose when you're with them who you like and who you don't like. And there's some who are so egotistical, it's not much fun. Others you take a liking to, and they're down to earth, and they've got their feet on the ground, and they're not pretending to be somebody they're not. So I think it comes with success, you know, and success comes in so many different shapes and sizes. So as long as you keep your head together, you don't get big-headed, you don't get carried away with your own importance. That's a major error that most people have. If you go to a motor show, one of the international motor shows, you see some of these people who might be head of sales and marketing, who might be a vice president. He never walks alone. He's always got an entourage, and he's always in front. And right there, you see somebody you don't want to be with. And the chances are he's got a bigger impression of his own importance than reality is a fact. So, you know, if you get carried away, you usually fall down. And we all fall down from time to time. It's how you get back up again and keep the truck moving. But I don't think there's anything fancy about it. I think it's just focus. It's long-term. I mean, I wrote a book called Winning is Not Enough. That's exactly true. Winning is easy. Everybody in this room has already won at something. I don't care whether it's tiddlywinks, table tennis, anything. We all win. Winning itself is not enough. What you want is serial winning. To do serial winning, you just got to use a little grey cells. I can't think like the clever folk. I can't think like any of you. You're far too clever for me. And I can't do it. I just can't do it. What I do is think out the box. I find other ways of doing business. Because of my dyslexia, I cannot do it. I'm on the board of Moët Hennessy. On the car coming up here, I had to phone my accountant for him to explain something that I'm going to do at a board meeting the day after tomorrow, because I didn't understand it. It's going to be explained in simple terms for me. So you don't have to be Einstein. Einstein was dyslexic, for God's sake. Leonardo da Vinci was dyslexic. I mean, a huge number of people were dyslexic. But it's an advantage, because all of you, be very careful, all of you are so damn clever, but you all think down the same road. Education tells you to think. If you go to the States and go to Harvard, you'd come out of Harvard with a series of thinking processes and fashions of doing your business. And of course, it's not bad to know that. But if you keep going down that same road, the way they tell you, there's a hell of a lot of other people been to Stanford or Harvard, and they're thinking the same way. Richard Branson thinks out the box, totally dyslexic. So when you think out the box, you get success on your own, because you do the things that other people haven't seen. In my case, I'm the president of the menial task division. That's all I do, menial tasks. I'm very good at windows, I'm very good at floors, and I'm available on weekends. And there wouldn't be a streak in any of my windows, I guarantee you, because my attention to detail is so focused, you can't allow anything to go wrong. And if I don't let anything go wrong by leaving streaks in the window or dirty floor, then I'm going to get that job of cleaning the floors or cleaning the windows every week. So that's the way I've done it. That's the only way I know. And it hasn't been too bad for me. This side of the house. I'm going to allow a young man here to ask the question. What's that young fella? Because he's obviously going to be brilliant.
Other than yourself, who would you rate as the best racing driver ever? And how would you compare them to drivers today?
Well, my hero, I told you earlier, was Fangio. I thought he was the best. He drove smoothly, cleanly, never ran into people, had very few accidents. He had dignity and style with it, and therefore represented the sport well and went around the world and did great things. Jim Clark was the best racing driver I ever raced against, without fear of contradiction. And it was he who taught me how to be smooth and gentle and get a car to do the things you want it to do. There's quite a few girls in here, right? I've got a few tips for you. Do you have a boyfriend? And she tells fibs. Right. If you had a boyfriend, any of you girls who are in here, let me tell you what you've got to do. You've got to treat your boyfriends, plural even, treat your boyfriends as I would treat a racing car. I would want to be very gentle with it. I don't want to bully it, because it'll hurt me, it'll upset me, it won't handle being bullied. I would gently coax it into doing the things that I want it to do. I would gently brake. I wouldn't bang the brake pedal. At the gas pedal, I'd give it a little introduction before I give it the full throttle. And I'd win the race. I'd get the deal. I would make it happen. That's how you've got to treat that future ex-boyfriend. So, that's the way you drive cars. That's the way Fangio drove a car. That's the way that Jim Clark drove a car. I think Vettel's as good as they come at 25 years of age. I think Alonso at the present probably has the best toolbox of any driver mentally. And I think he may be the best right now. But Vettel's only 25. I've never seen a more mature 25 driving a Formula One racing car ever. Other people are fast. But I think those two are outstanding at the present time to answer the question. Another question. In the front row here, he has authority, obviously.
You've clearly had a very long and illustrious career, and you talk about your career with great passion and enthusiasm. If you were able to wind the clock back...
If I what?
If you were able to wind the clock back, what year would you go to and why?
Dear. I think my motor racing years, I wouldn't change very much apart from the black marks on the road, you know, the deaths. Everything else, I mean, I had some years better than others and some not so good years. But I think you have to have disappointments. You have to learn from making the wrong decisions. And then you build on that to avoid doing the same again. You've got to avoid doing the same again. Some people are serious error makers. That's not what you need. My motor racing career ran pretty well for me. But I chose very good people. And again, the choice of who you align yourself with. Sometimes they offer you more money, but it's not as good a job. Or you don't see the potential work quite as well. Commercially, I could have made more money than I've made, and I'm not short of money. Well, of course, as a Scotsman, there's never quite enough. But I might have moved slightly differently. For years and years and years, I delivered without asking any return. I thought a retainer was enough. I could have made a lot more money had I been working on commissions. I never did that. Only recently, in recent years, have I gone that route. But it didn't do me any harm. So looking back, it's not that I haven't made any mistakes, but I've been so fortunate that it would be difficult for me to say, God, that was terrible, or I would love to replace that. I don't think there's anything in my life that I could say that I've been disappointed by, or, God, I wish we hadn't done that. So I'm a lucky boy in that respect. Yes.
In the past few seasons, a few younger drivers, for example, Grosjean and Maldonado, have come in under a lot of flack for sometimes being described as dangerous drivers. Because of the increase in safety, are we perhaps reaching the point where some drivers are not being as careful as they should be in Formula One?
Maldonado came in to the Williams team with £23 million from Venezuelan fuel company and got a ride for Williams. And Williams needed the money at the time. He's a kind of bully driver, and he's proven that several times. To be avoided, really, on the track. Grosjean is very fast, but was very impetuous, had 7 accidents out of 11 starts on the first lap last year. He's learned from that. He had a mechanical failure on Sunday in Spain. It wasn't a coming together with anyone. I think he could have finished in the top 6 on Sunday. I think he's got potential if he can just thread the needle the right way. There's so many almost very good racing drivers. It's the same as any sport. There's only one Chris Hoy who's been able to win more medals in the Olympics of cycling, more medals than any Brit in any form of Olympic sports, even more than Stephen Redgrave, who's dyslexic, by the way. So I guess if you keep making mistakes, you shouldn't be there. And they won't be there because it costs a lot of money, not just for the repair of the vehicle, but for the loss of World Championship Constructors' Championship points. So you need to finish races. To finish first you must finish. And that's something that I learned to do very early on. Yes. This is a difficult question coming up. it's a lady that's going to ask me a question.
Stirling Moss recently said that he didn't think that females possibly had the mental capacity to be great racing drivers. Maybe it is a slightly difficult question. But I know that, well, at least I believe that you're a great supporter of Susie Wolfe, so you obviously don't have that opinion. And do you think we will soon see a Formula One, a female Formula One racing driver soon?
There is no reason at all for a woman not to make the top of Formula One. There's no reason at all. It's not physical. I mean, if I think back to when I was getting into Formula One, in those days, the East German female swimmers were sort of up here and would have crushed me. So it wasn't strength that was missing. There's not enough gals driving carts. If you go to a kart track just now, 85 to 90% of the kids running around there at the age of 8, 9 years of age are boys. So how are we going to get a gal into Formula One who would be any good unless she's as good as those boys? It's not just because she's a pretty face or she's a gal that would be getting a drive. It's just not. She's got to be delivering performance. So if there's hundreds of millions of people in the world have driving licenses, of those, a few million have competition licenses. Of those, a few hundred thousand are regular performers. And of those, a few thousand get paid for it. And out of those, a few hundred get paid quite a lot. And out of those, there are 24 Formula One drivers that have won everything in the formulas that they've come up in every country and every continent to get to Formula One. And out of those 24, there's only 6 that are any good at one time. And out of those 6, there's only 3 that are exceptional. And at one time, there's only 1 genius, usually. Now, that batting average, that's what's stopping girls doing it. If there was more girls in it, there's nothing wrong. I mean, Danica Patrick won an IndyCar race in Japan, was in pole position in Daytona 500. She's a small gal, but she's a hell of a good driver. But she's won. So there needs to be a great raft of girl racing drivers. Can you imagine the money that a girl racing driver would make? You know, the cosmetics, the clothing. God knows, you'd be more privileged than you are today. You'd be given more help. You'd be given more money. A top female racing driver would be dynamite. And it would be very good for the sport if she got to Formula One. And there's no physical reason. I mean, Stirling Moss said the other day they wouldn't have the mental strength. Boy, I wouldn't like to be Stirling Moss walking down the high street. And he, by the way, was a considerable expert with girls. So he's probably had more experience than I, and maybe therefore he's a better judge, but I don't think so. I think it's simply that. It's simply averages. Am I allowed to ask one more question? Or one more question at the end there.
Just a short one. What was your best race win, you think?
My best race? My personal best race? Everybody thinks the Nürburgring in the wet and the fog and that, all that. I was pretty pleased with that race. But I think my best race ever was when I finished fourth in the Italian Grand Prix in my last year because I had a puncture on the third lap. Picked up, nail or something. And in those days, pit stops weren't very slick. Now we have a pit stop and you can do it in 2.3 seconds changing 4 wheels. I think it took a week and a day for my guys to change the tire. But anyway, I regained the race and went from the very back. And at the beginning of the race, when you lose it, all the cars are way, way ahead of you. And I picked up, I did more fastest laps than any other time in my career, and maybe than anyone else has ever done for a whole race. And I finished fourth, and by finishing fourth, clinched the world championship. Nobody would say that was one of my best races. All the media will go and say it was the Nürburgring, or it was the British Grand Prix in 69, or Monza winning in 69, again, that Grand Prix to win the world championship. But to finish fourth from the very back of the grid, I mean, the real back behind, because I couldn't see any cars on the track, that was probably the best race for me. Before I leave you, I'm going to do one small thing. This is not a speech. I jotted down the things that you need to make the big time in whatever you choose to do. And this is only my opinion, you understand. But listen to them. Attention to detail. Never lose that. That's what makes the difference. A lot of clever folk will run over the little items. Attention to detail will get you. Present yourself well. I came here tonight and I was told I could be casual. I'm wearing a tie. I'm wearing a jacket. I'm not wearing jeans. I'm wearing a pair of flannels. That's not because I'm 73 years of age. I thought, I've got to be safe. I've got to be sure. If I drive myself or get somebody to drive me up here and I walk in looking not so good, it's not a good example. And if I were going for a job or trying to impress somebody, what I choose to wear and how I present myself is very important. Learn to communicate. Communication is the absolute key to every door. If you're a good communicator, from the question back there, you get to be with great and important people because you're communicating and they're interested and they love being asked questions. There's not a person, a clever person I know, that doesn't like to be asked for help or advice. So be a good communicator. Put more hours in than anybody else. You categorically, no matter if you finish something, go the extra yard, like Paul did. Go the extra yard, and you will be helping somebody else they'll never forget. They'll never forget that you helped them. Put the hours in. Over-deliver. Don't over-promise and under-deliver. Under-promise and over-deliver. Then they're impressed because they don't believe that anybody says they're going to get things done in such and such a time or in such and such a fashion. If you under-promise and over-deliver, you'll get more credit than you can imagine. Ask for advice. People love being asked for advice because it means that you're asking them because you think they are cleverer than you and therefore will help you and give you advice. Nobody objects to giving you advice. You may not have to take it. You may choose not to use it. But they'll be flattered that you asked, and it may be the right answer that you get that's going to help you. Call people back. Like I said earlier, all the really important people call me back. Chris Hoy called me back today because I tried to get him earlier and it was in voicemail. Call me back immediately. Anybody, I don't know, I was speaking to somebody else today, quite important. Oh, Prince of Monaco. Because I'm going there in a few days. He called me back. Now, if you call people back, they appreciate that. And a lot of people say, well, it's okay, I'm not going to call them back. Even if it's somebody you don't want to give the answer to, call them back. They'll always remember that. They'll always give you credit. Choose people well. Stay away from the crows. Go with the eagles. You'll always learn from the eagles. And there's no free lunches. You've got to pay back. A lot of people want to soak. All the sycophantics that hang on after me, you know, I don't want them. I don't need them. So there's no free lunches. You've got to earn your lunch. And the most important thing of all, find new ways of doing business. don't go down the same road as everybody else. Too congested. Don't take the M25 on a Friday night. Same thing. So if you do all of these things, you'll get more success than you believe that you could have in most cases. But above all, you've got to deliver. Thank you all very much. Thank you.
I'd like to thank Sir Jackie for that fantastic speech and thank him for coming to the uni. It's certainly been the highlight of my term. I've been looking forward to it since it was announced in the term card, so thank you very much. Just a few other things for those of you that are coming up this week. On Thursday, we have our debate, which will feature the supermodel Lily Cole and the founder of Wikipedia, Jimmy Wales, amongst others. And please don't forget to buy tickets to the Union Garden Party, which will be on Friday, the 14th of June. So thank you very much. And can I ask you again to thank Sir Jackie Stewart for coming? Fantastic speech. Thank you.